Welcome back to Bitwig featuring the grid. Today's modular concept is feedback. Now, the first time most people encountered feedback, it was unpleasant because it was unwanted. But when feedback is created intentionally, like this clearly leftward moving patch chord, you actually have an opportunity to do something colorful and interesting with the sound. Because each iteration that passes, each signal that makes it back, then gets reshaped and successively reshaped and reshaped. And it's quite an interesting opportunity for sound design and other programming. Now, Bitwig is an interesting place to work with feedback because some of our regular devices themselves have feedback chains. In this case, here's the Delay 2 device. I've just loaded a preset from the factory contents, Freak Shift Delay, Frequency Shifting Delay. Now, inside of that nested chain, the device is turned off. So right now, we're just hearing normal feedback if we run some audio through it. So if we increase the feedback amount on these channels, on the left and right channel, this is Delay 2, the stereo feedback, then you just get, let me turn off the detuning, why not? You just get more and more iterations. Like when I stop here, the signal was only scaled down so much and then passed back to the input, so you get repetitions. You get the signal coming back. Now, what makes feedback interesting is when you actually change, whether it's audio or video or whatever the signal is coming in, when you actually change it on the way through. So in this case, the Freak Shifter device, frequency shifter again, you can already hear each iteration is getting turned up a little bit frequency-wise. A little strong on the feedback side. So if we play around sound design-wise for a minute and do a kind of typical, let's say, duple-triple pattern, a 3-to-2, and then maybe offset the frequency amount in a similar ratio, about a third. So now both channels are going to end up in about the same place, even though they're going at different times. Now, the delay devices are not the only devices in Bitwig that have specific slots for this. If we go back to the first sound we were playing with, after the effects grid with its own feedback, there was a reverb, and our reverb device has the tank effects slot, which allows you, in this case, let's just turn it up, you can see on the yellow spectrum already, we're basically shifting up an octave, the signal going through the reverb between all of the reverberations. So if we were to adjust this amount, you'll watch the spectrum move and also hear the sound moving. Put it to about a fifth. So you can hear that already. Or we just play around and say, well, it would be much nicer down an octave, wouldn't it? And you get some reinforcement there. So there are various ways in the devices. And remember, for any of these effects chains, one, anything put in here does get stored within a preset that you save, which is important because it's part of the sound and an interesting way to make rich presets. But two, it doesn't have to be a Bitwig device. It could be a VST plugin or anything else that you can think of. So if we switch over and look at the synthesis side of things for a minute, here is the Phase 4 device. Play a note. We're just getting some sine waves out. Maybe we hear it a little bit stronger. So I've made both the Y, the yellow and magenta oscillator sections, to have exactly the same settings. We're only listening to the yellow right now, but if we were to turn up magenta, it's exactly the same thing. They're both set at 1-to-1 ratios, so they are of the same frequency. Everything else is identical. Now, the options that you get in this phase modulation section of the synthesizer is how much is a different oscillator, in this case, the magenta oscillator, affecting the phase of the yellow. So if we take a look, you'll see it starting to shift towards a sawtooth. It sounds like it a little bit. We can get that spectrum on screen. So it is all harmonics, but in a different proportion than a normal sawtooth, hence the funny shape. But remember, the yellow oscillator is configured exactly the same as the magenta oscillator. So we could, in fact, do a yellow feedback routing to send the output back to the input, which starts in a similar fashion. But then remember that this changed output signal is the new input signal. It's not a pure sine wave getting fed in anymore. So things are going to start heading towards instability pretty quickly, because the change is more extreme. So again, if we think in a sound design way for a moment and see how this applies in Bitwig devices in general, maybe I take velocity sensitivity, get that to drive the feedback amount of each note. So now we could play different notes, have some of them soft, and some of them rather strong. And maybe sitting still is a little bit boring. So we could also take a classic LFO, make it move nice and slow, say every 2 bars is a cycle, and have it also move that parameter a little bit too. Because again, animating these parameters, especially slowly over time, is going to result in something more interesting. Maybe start with a little bit of the phase distortion in there as well. It's almost my rhythmic element already. Not sure I meant to make windshield wipers, but here we are. So let's go back to the grid to close things out. And I've got a small patch to begin with to create some kind of feedback, maybe in an instability sense. So this little starter patch is really just 2 oscillators, 2 triangles. One, which has an LFO doing some amplitude modulation on its output. It's at pitch regularly. And the other one, which is just slightly stereo detuned from the first oscillator, but otherwise, they're all layered up, bandpass filtered with keyboard tracking, and then, again, a little AM-RM module here using velocity input so that not every single note is actually triggering the same volume. Now, we've got this simple oscillator here, so this might be a nice place, like with the phase 4 example, to take the signal coming out of the entire synth, both oscillators, and put it back to the phase input of the triangle. So I can draw a chord here, I can let go, and I will get nothing. That's because feedback is not generally allowed in the grid without the addition of a special module. The long delay module, even in the description there, is telling you that it is made to allow feedback connections. So this is a special one. It's made differently than everything else. So once I do this, and I'm going to go ahead and set it to the shortest delay time available. If I go ahead and draw the patch chord now, which is still circular, it's still going from an output back to an input in that same signal, it is allowed. I am allowed to have a signal. So now that feedback is allowed, play a few notes and start opening that phase modulation input. Yeah. So you've got that border in there where things start to explode a little bit. And again, different velocities per note means certain notes are exploding and others are not. So that's interesting to begin with. And since we're here in the signal domain, we can actually process the signal and shape the sound a little bit instead of just one flat knob saying how much feedback all the time. So let's go ahead and add some adjustments. Perhaps we don't want this to go the entire time. So we can add an envelope, another AR. It basically fades the feedback, the phase modulation feedback in over time. But that's still a little quick and not quite what I want. So let's go ahead and disable the pre-chord, which is coming straight from the keyboard. Go get the gate input, because again, when things are signals, we can process them. So in one of our recent updates, we added a simple note delay module, some delay times to all of the envelope modulators, and then on the module level, there is the logic delay, which allows you to say, in this mode, I only want to delay the start of each gate signal, not the off. So when the keyboard is released, it's just going to return to zero immediately. But now the envelope's going to wait for about 3 seconds. Before it ramps in. And maybe I don't want it to stay up all the way. So let's switch over to an ADSR so the sustain level can be down a bit. So there, now we've got some amount of instability. Maybe we keep it up a little bit longer, a little higher. Interesting. There's something. Maybe on top of that, we could add a little wave shaping to the entire signal that's being delayed itself. Perhaps a wave folder would be nice. Again, let's go helpfully trying to color code things for myself. That's pretty strong. So maybe instead of it happening all the time, let's think that I've got maybe an MPE keyboard or something where the drum pads send pressure per note. The pressure in here, it will support channel pressure or aftertouch if that's all that your keyboard has available. But if it happens to have poly pressure, whether it's MPE or drum pads or whatever, it will use that instead so that we can have per note values. So I'll hold a note, nice low one, and as I push a little harder, there we go. We're getting a signal over time. Now, how do we take a signal and have it modulate a parameter that does not have an input control? Well, at the end of the I/O category is the helpful modulator out device, which turns any signal into a modulator signal that can target anything inside of the grid patch or in a device outside of the grid. So let's set this somewhere around an octave and a fifth, because this is essentially adding cycles to the wave. So if I play and hold a note, and then as I push, so each individual note can now have its own level. So now if we play some high notes and then add some of the low notes and then only add pressure to the low notes over time. Definitely got some tension and instability going on. So again, feedback can be interesting when it is what you want. And as with anything, there is great responsibility that comes with it. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you again soon.